Appwrite is a backend-as-a-service tool that provides your application with basic services such as databases, buckets for uploading files, user management, and more. It is positioning itself as a highly viable alternative to Firebase, in part thanks to the fact that it is completely open source, with which you can host it on your own server and have absolute control over your backend data and fully manage the cost of maintaining the service. Something impossible to do with Firebase. In this video, I'm going to make a short introduction about the features of Appwrite, and I'm also going to teach you how to install it on your own virtual machine or on your server. After that, I'm going to create a very simple Flutter app to test our newly installed backend so you can quickly begin to work with it. But let's start at the beginning. What exactly is Appwrite and what advantages does it offer over what is probably the most famous backend as a service tool in the Flutter ecosystem, namely Firebase? Well, as defined on its own website, Appwrite is a self-hosted backend as a service platform that provides developers with all the core APIs required to build any application. We are talking about a completely open source application licensed under the BSD3 license. You can download, install, and use it on your own server free of charge for any type of project, be it personal or commercial. Its current functionalities include the creation of multiple object-oriented databases with a granular permission system, which even allow us to set permissions at the level of individual entries. A bucket-based storage system that also provides a granular permission system. User management, including user authentication and the ability to create cloud functions in a bunch of different runtimes. And this is one of the points that interests me the most, because unlike other backend as a service tools such as Firebase or Supabase, in Appwrite you can create cloud functions in many languages. The currently supported languages are Node.js, PHP, Python, Ruby, Deno, Swift, .NET, Kotlin, Java, C++, and Dart. That is, you could have your complete stack, mobile app and the backend in pure Dart language. Since Appwrite is hosted on your server, you will have full control over everything that happens on it. You will not have to trust third parties to manage your service, which results in greater privacy for your users. This also has an impact on the cost, since it will be completely predictable. You will pay for the type of machine you have and no more. Now that we have a general idea of what Appwrite offers, let's install it on our server and test it from within a Flutter app. The first thing we are going to need is a server. If you want to try the service, all you have to do is create a virtual machine. Or if you have a server in the cloud, you can also install it there. It is important that if you are using a server with internet access, you secure it properly. If you want to learn how to secure a Linux server, I leave you a link to a video in which I explain how to apply a basic security scheme. Appwrite is very easy to install. It uses Docker for it. The first thing we have to do is access our server through SSH. From here, we will follow the instructions on the official Docker page to install it. We run apt-get-update to update dependencies and install these necessary packages. We continue with the instructions that the page indicates. Of course, I leave you a link to these instructions in the description of the video. Finally, after another apt-get update, we can install all Docker binaries. Now, we're going to prove that the installation has been completed successfully. For this, we execute this image that the guide indicates us. If we see this text, it means that the image has been downloaded and has been executed successfully. We already have everything ready to install Appwrite. For this, we go to its official documentation where we see that only with this single command we can install it. I also leave the link to this page in the description of the video. The first thing Docker will do is download all the images that are needed to run Appwrite. Now, the installer will ask us for the HTTP port and the HTTPS port that we want. We leave the default values. It then asks us to enter a secret API key. In my case, I'm going to leave it by default. And if you are using a test virtual machine, you can also do it. But if you are configuring Appwrite for a real environment, it is important that you generate a secure API key and keep it safe. Then it will ask us for the hostname and a DNSA record. I'm going to leave the default values. If you have a domain pointing to the server, enter it to be able to access the dashboard through your domain. Appwrite will now finish its configuration and then it will boot up. We can now access the dashboard through the IP of the machine, or through the domain we have done the configuration. You may see a warning from your browser. In my case, it's because the browser is trying to access via HTTPS, but there is no valid certificate. We tell him to advance anyway. It is our server, and obviously nothing bad is going to happen. Once inside, we create an administrator account, entering a name, an email, and a password. Appwrite is ready. Now we're going to create a Flutter app to start using this tool. The first thing I'm going to do is create a new project. For this, we click on Create Project and we enter a name. You can let it auto-generate an ID or you can enter a manual ID if you want. If we go to the settings, we will see the project ID and the endpoint that we will need later to connect. Now I'm going to create a new Flutter app. The first thing is to remove all comments from PubSpec and add the necessary dependencies, which will be the Appwrite package and file picker. We're going to use the latter to select a local file and upload it to Appwrite. Now open main.dart and remove the existing widget. I'm going to rename my app to app and remove comments. I'm going to create a main screen, which will inherit from stateful widget. Now you have to declare the necessary objects. First, it will be an object of type client, which is the main connection bridge with Appwrite. The account object will serve to have an open user session, databases to interact with the databases, and storage to upload files. I'm going to declare this feature here and you'll see soon what it's for. Now I'm going to initialize all these objects in init state. For the client, we will have to define the endpoint and the project ID. You can find this data in the settings section of the Appwrite dashboard. In my case, I will define them in a separate file. Now we initialize the account. We also initialize databases. For this, it asks us for the ID of the database, but we haven't created yet. So let's go to the dashboard and create a database. I'm going to set its ID and name as main. I also initialize the storage. To finish the setup, I'm going to create this method that will be used to create an anonymous user session. In order to offer safe usage and enforce API quotas, Appwrite always needs a logged in user. We could do this by creating a user with email and password, but to simplify this tutorial, we will create an anonymous session that does not need that data. This anonymous session can be created using the create anonymous session method. But calling this method a second time will throw an error, since Appwrite stores the session. For this reason, we put a call to get inside a try to see if there is a session. If there is not, it will throw an error and we can generate it in the catch block. We will now start building the UI in the build method. This will return a scaffold, in whose body I will create a future builder that will use the future that we just defined to make sure that there is a session set against Appwrite. Now I'm going to add a button that will create a record against the database. First, we go to the dashboard and enter the database. The first thing to do is define a collection. Appwrite databases are object-oriented, which means that they are organized into documents, which are in turn contained into collections. We create a collection with ID and name test. Now, we can define the type of permissions we want, which can be at the collection level or at the file level. In order not to complicate this tutorial, we're going to choose at file level for now. That means that if a client creates a record, he or she will have full access to that record, but to no other. Of course, all this behavior can be adjusted. Leave me a comment if you're interested in me making a video exploring different configurations regarding the Appwrite permission system. Now we have to define the attributes of each object. Unlike in Firebase, in Appwrite we have to define the schema of each object. We're going to create an attribute of type string with ID message, with a maximum length of 4096 bytes, and that is also mandatory. Now I'm going to create this method where I'm going to create a database entry from the app. To do this, I define this try-catch block to handle errors. Through the databases object, we can interact with the database. Calling createDocument, we can create a document. We have to specify in which collection and with which ID. Now, I want Appwrite to auto-generate an ID for me, so I pass unique as the value. In data, we create a map with a message property, which we just define as an attribute of the objects in this collection. I'm going to show the result of this operation, whether it goes right or wrong, in a snack bar. We run this method from the button we just added. Before we can run this test, we have to configure this platform. To do this, we go to the home section of the dashboard, and there we click on Add Platform. We select New Flutter App. For this test, I'm going to add just Android. Give it a name and enter the bundle ID, which will be in the build.gradle file. I'm going to change the ID and add it to the dashboard. Now, I'm going to run this app on an emulator. If we have done everything right, we will see that we have created a record in the database. We can access its details in the dashboard. Now, I'm going to try to upload a file that is in the emulator to the Appwrite bucket. For this, I'm going to create another method similar to the previous one, also specifying this scaffold messenger that will be used later to show the result of the operation. By the way, it's important to define this scaffold messenger here since there's going to be an async gap afterwards, so it's recommended for safety to define it before the await call. First, we need to select a local file. For this, the file picker plugin provides us with this pickfiles method that handles the permission request and opens a file browser. Now, through the storage object, we use createFile to upload a file. But first, we go to the dashboard to create the bucket with which we are going to work. In storage, we click on Add Bucket. I'm going to set main as ID and name. And I'm going to select file level permissions for the same reason as before. We enter the ID of the bucket that we just created. As the file ID, we pass it unique again so that it auto-generates the ID. And in file, we pass an object of type input file with the name and path of the file. I'm going to add another button to the UI so I can call this method. If we have done everything right, we can select a local file to upload it to Appwrite. From the dashboard, we can see the file we just uploaded. We have already seen what Appwrite is, how to install it, and how to start interacting with it through a Flutter app. Leave me a comment if you are interested in me creating a more realistic example with user registration and authentication, use of granular permissions, and creation of cloud functions in pure Dart. If you found this video useful, please leave a like, and consider subscribing for more content related to Flutter and Appwrite. I hope you have a beautiful rest of your day. I'll see you in the next video. Goodbye.